Hey, how's it going, everybody? So one thing most of you probably don't know about me is the fact that I was on board the USS Gettysburg in the United States Navy for a number of years. I know, believe it or not, yes, yours truly was actually... Okay, all jokes aside, my time in the Navy was some of the best years of my life. I made some great friends, I got to see some amazing places, and I got in loads and loads of trouble. I decided one day I wanted to find and build a model of the Gettysburg to help commemorate the years I was in the Navy, but everything I could find was either really old and out of print, or it was just so small I didn't think it was going to be worth building. I spent the next couple of years scouring the internet, digging through every online hobby shop I could find, and lo and behold, one afternoon by accident, I found the Dragon Models 1/350th scale USS Mobile Bay. Now, you're right, it's not the USS Gettysburg, but it is still a Ticonderoga class ship, and it is still a guided missile cruiser, so I figured, you know what, a win is a win, and I went ahead and I placed the order. Now, I was really nervous about this because I was ordering from some no-name shop in the middle of nowhere. I knew this model was old. I'd been looking for a long time. You can see right here on the box, it says it was issued in like 2001. I didn't start looking for it until 2007, and then I found it and ordered it in 2012. So this thing was already a decade old by the time I found it, and I had no idea what condition this thing was going to be in. I figured the box was going to show up all smashed and crunched, probably sun faded within an inch of its life, and God knows what would be going on with the parts inside. Fortunately for me, I was pleasantly surprised. This gamble paid off. I unboxed it when I first got it, that's why all the pieces are out of the plastic, it wasn't just loose like this. But I wanted to go through and do an inventory and, you know, drool over it as soon as I got it. There was very little damage. I was really surprised. For being a decade old and who knows what this box had been through in its days, that little bit of discoloring on the tip of the bullnose there was really the only damage I found. There was one other part that had to be heated and kind of bent back into place, but I'll talk about that later. So yeah, going through and inventorying all the pieces, I wanted to go through and look for like glaring inaccuracies, things that were going to be needed to, you know, address before I start building it, as well as looking for opportunities to buy aftermarket parts. Like these propellers, I know for a fact that they make these really nice brass propellers. They really catch the light really well. I ordered some. I don't know that I'm going to use them or not. I'll talk about that later as well. I've got some really cool plans for this model in the long run, but going through all of these pieces and looking at all these sprues, none of the pieces had fallen off and were rattling around in the box, and everything seemed to be in good order. And I even started to get nostalgic, you know, looking at things like, oh, I remember I got in trouble right there once. I got yelled at right there once. But anyway, going through looking at these things, everything was in good order. There were some options I thought was pretty clever. They give you multiple helos so you can build one fully, you know, extended and on the flight deck, or you could fold one up and tuck it into the helo hanger. Another thing that I noticed almost right away, each large ship, or at least our ship, had a small rescue boat and a really nice captain's gig. And this version of what I'm guessing is their rescue boat, it was not the same as ours. We had a rigid hull inflatable boat, or RIB for short, and we didn't have this little rowboat looking thing. So I got online and I found a nice set of aftermarket parts. It's an enhanced captain's gig and the correct RIB boat. So I placed the order for those. I don't know where it's coming from or how long it's going to take to get here, but it's on its way. The brass propellers are on their way. And man, look how tiny these chaff launchers are. I mean, I'm not foreshadowing anything, but I guarantee I'm going to lose at least one of those. Anyway, going back to the options, here's our VLS, the vertical launch system that we had on the Gettysburg, so for a fact, those are going to get used. This Mark 26 rocket launcher, we did not have that, so that's going to end up in a drawer collecting dust. And then last but not least, I pulled out the decal sheet and was surprised. I figured it'd be all old and crusty and yellow, but they were in really good shape. I know I'll be able to use the bow numbers and a lot of the other decals, like the warning circles and so on, but there are some decals missing, like the word Gettysburg that goes across the fantail. Fortunately, years ago I found this Inkjet Waterslide decal paper. I'll put a link in the description below. It essentially does exactly that. It lets you print your own waterslide decals at home. So between lucking out and getting a model that was in really good shape, had all its pieces and no visible damage, a couple of aftermarket parts on order and a few tricks up my sleeve like custom printed decals, I was really starting to get excited to put the Gettysburg together. Over the years, I pulled this box out every now and then and would peruse the pieces and tell myself I really need to get this built, and it would go back in the box, safe and sound, put away for when I actually really had time to build it. So not long ago, when I redesigned my channel, one of the first things I decided to do was the Gettysburg project. Finally, after years and years and years, the USS Gettysburg model has finally hit the model building desk and it's time to get started. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to bore you with hours and hours of footage. I'm just going to hit some high points along the way. If you've built a model of any kind before, it's pretty straightforward. You follow the directions, you pay attention, or you're going to miss a step, you're going to miss a piece and screw something up. So I busted out my trusty side cutters and started getting to work on the hull. Now, one thing I said earlier in the unboxing portion is that I had plans for this, and the end goal is to have the model completely built, detailed, painted, and then I want to submerge it halfway in epoxy resin. I don't want to do the wake and all the churning water on the surface. I want it nice and clean and still. But I definitely want to go ahead and submerge it in resin and make a diorama, make the bottom look like the ocean floor, etc. I'm getting way ahead of myself, but the point I'm getting at is knowing that the hull is going to be submerged in resin, I'll never be able to get to it and touch it up again. So I wanted to make sure that bottom seam was nice and clean. The inside, it's all gnarly and full of super glue, who cares? But the outside, I used little bits of putty in some places to fill in some little gaps, and started basically just sanding and cleaning it up. Again, I'm not gonna bore you with hours of footage of me sitting here sanding. But the more time you put into these models, the better they look in general. So taking my time to really, really get that seam out and get it as smooth as possible was a priority. I'm also banking on the fact that when I get it in the primer booth, I'll be able to lay on enough primer, not too thick to smother any detail, but thick enough, especially across the bottom, to hide any part of that seam that I wasn't able to completely sand out. So here I've got it in my spray booth, and I'm applying Badger Steinel Res primer using their basic gray. Now, unfortunately, this isn't haze gray. It would be great to kill two birds with one stone, but that's not going to happen. So I gave it multiple generous coats of primer. I'd let it dry for a few minutes, come back, mostly across that bottom seam, and continue to hit it with primer until I was satisfied that that line had pretty much disappeared. There's one place towards the back that it wasn't perfect, but I mean, it's close enough. And that back section is gonna have the propellers and the shafts covering it up, so I think it'll be less noticeable. But primarily the bow, the sonar dome, and that bottom seam. And I'll worry about filling those holes later. So I think maybe 5 coats of primer across the bottom, and she came out really well. So getting her out of the primer booth after she had a chance to dry overnight and taking a look at her, it's really smooth. I was pretty pleased with that. There's only a few places I can kind of tell, mostly towards the back, like I said, but in general, I couldn't be more pleased with the way the hull turned out. And again, I wish that gray was the right color, but you know, it is what it is. So while I was waiting on that to dry, I went ahead and I started doing some sub-assemblies. I started putting together some of the superstructure. I did have to pre-paint the inside of the helo hanger to make sure, because there was no way I was gonna try and get a bent angled brush in there later. That's just, no, not gonna happen. The rest of it, I don't have any major obstacles. I'm not really worried about painting any other portion of it, but inside of the helo hanger had to be addressed. So again, skipping through all the boring build footage, here we are with some sub-assemblies done. For the most part, we're getting to the point where it's ready to paint. There's a little bit more assembly, it's the detail work to go, but there's some weird gaps in some places that just didn't make sense, like in the edge of where the superstructure meets the flight deck. But some of these pieces, like these lifeboats and the chaff launchers, that was ridiculous. I mean, those things are smaller than a grain of rice, and I've got my magnifying glasses and tweezers, and I'm amazed I didn't lose any of those pieces. This side still has some more detailing to go, but I went ahead and started getting sub-assemblies done so that I'll be able to paint these individually. And I don't mean the individual stacks. I'm going to glue as much of it together as I can, but I didn't want to try to hold the entire thing while building it, so I got that first portion done. Here you can see the pilot house with some of the radar components on top. I'm hoping all this goes together pretty well. All the dry fitting worked out. I didn't have any serious gaps other than that one that I pointed out near the helo hanger earlier. But getting some of these sub-assemblies done made me feel better. I'll be able to get these on there, and it's not going to be a chore to worry about knocking things over, because I've done it before. You glue something together, you get excited, you move on to something else, and next thing you know, you break the last thing you glued, or you knock off an antenna. So I decided putting these things together in sub-assemblies, letting them dry overnight, and then coming back and getting them all put together was definitely going to be in my advantage. Here's the captain's gig I mentioned earlier, and it looks like the one we had, but it's not really a great version. So again, the rib boat comes with an enhanced captain's gig. I'm definitely going to use that instead. The 2 5-inch cannons are done here. I've seen where they sell brass metal gun barrels that are actually hollow, and I don't think I'm going to go that nuts with it. The harpoon launchers are put together and they're ready to go, so we'll set these off to the side. Couple little random pieces. This other little building off to my left here, I think that goes underneath the signal bridge. I'm not completely sure yet. I'm sure it'll all come together when I try to put all these little sub-assemblies in, you know, in their proper place. But for now, the majority of the building was done. Cutting a lot of pieces off the sprues was done, and now it was just a matter of letting these sub-assemblies dry and then getting them assembled. I mentioned earlier that in addition to the little bit of a bend on the bullnose, that I did find one other part that needed some surgery, and that were the propeller shafts. One of them was really bent and the supports were warped way out of whack, so I sparingly used some heat. I was able to warm it up, reshape the plastic and let it cool, and it held its shape properly, so getting those glued on was not as much of a challenge as I thought it was going to be. So yeah, all the sub-assemblies are done, we get them glued together, and I'm going to call this done for now. And what I mean by done for now is the bottom of this looks beautiful. I got the seam out of there, I got the piece, the propeller shaft repaired, and I got those glued on there. So this is what I'm going to leave the hull as for now, so that I have the freedom to paint it without worrying about knocking anything off, which I would probably end up doing if I glued the whole thing together. So we've got the fantail here, the harpoon, the 5-inch, the part of the superstructure on the aft there is all glued in together, and it came out great, no major problems. The forecastle looks good. The only thing I really had to put on there was the VLS and the 5-inch, and that tiny little hatch, that was annoying, but that's in there. But this being the majority of it, I'm going to leave it like this. Now, having these sub-assemblies mostly put together, and now I have 5 main pieces, it's going to give me the freedom to work on these and, you know, do some work on one part, set it off to the side, and work on another part. Because I guarantee you, if I'm not careful, I'm going to knock off a radar, or I'm going to flip it upside down and drop it and break some antenna. So being able to carefully work on one section and then put it down and work on something else is going to give me a little bit of peace of mind and a little bit of freedom. But this went together really well. I didn't have any major problems. There's a few little gaps to fill. But at this point, I'm going to leave it in these 5 pieces, and at least until I get the hull entirely painted and sealed, so that way I can not worry about fingerprints or scratching it with, you know, my fingernails or accidentally bumping it with a tool. I want to get the superstructure all painted and get everything as close to done as I can before gluing it together for the final assembly. So we're going to call this done for episode 1. Pretty straightforward unboxing and assembly. Episode 2 is going to be the painting. Again, I won't bore you with every minute of every hour of filmed footage, but I'll hit some highlights and show off my accomplishments as far as getting it painted as accurately and detailed as possible. Hopefully some of those aftermarket parts start rolling in. I'll be able to get those on as well. But all that's stuff for another video in the future. So, all right, thanks for watching. I know this was kind of a long one for now. Give this video a thumbs up if you like what's going on with the Gettysburg Project. Drop a comment in the section below if you've got something to add or share. Share this video with someone you think might get a kick out of it. And if you haven't yet, please subscribe to the all-new Egghead Albies. I've got a ton of great stuff coming your way. Thanks a lot, everyone. Get out of here. Go make something. We'll see you in the next video. Take care.